$50. PSA units are auto safety.
Oh, really?
I use them for anything. And all that the app does is show an arrow.
Left or right?
So there's this woman, I mean, with, you know, when you go to this airport security queues, and there's this guy standing, and he says, go left, right.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
That they have got a tablet there, and a person sitting there. And she taps on the screen, and it randomizes between 1 or 0 perhaps, and sometimes shows a left arrow, right arrow. So what do you do? Sometimes left, right, and you have to go in that direction.
That's it.
$1.1 million.
Well, supposedly the $4 million was for a contract with multiple projects involved. And that one was only like 47,000 or something.
Yeah,
that's
not
$37,000.
No, but,
wow.
But the invoice was for $336.
I'm sorry?
The invoice.
Oh,
actually, the invoice.
That's
$336. Just for the software. $336K US.
And
the guy who has written this blog, he actually demoed making the app.
But think of the good ones.
Teams. Thanks everyone for coming. Thanks also to people for putting their hands up to present. That's really exciting. I appreciate that. Nick is going to start us off with the interview, and it's a bit of discussion. If you've got some stuff to add, you know, please do, because we're all kind of stitching around looking at different blog posts and, you know, different bits and pieces. So I'm sure if you have picked up on some little bits and pieces, we'd love to hear about it too. And after that, it's Sergey is going to give us a talk about architecture in Android. And a little bit of discussion on Kotlin as well. So we'll look at that, and then we'll back up to Nick, who's going to run us through some of the basic news. So we'll say some announcements. Firstly, I just want to let you guys know that this is being live streamed. it's a bit of a preview. Playing around.
No swearing.
Hopefully, in the future, you can check it out. So just so you know, it's, you know, you don't want to embarrass yourself.
Vampire.
It's not being recorded though, so you don't need to worry about that. as Julia said, some of you have been playing around with Android and have a device in. So if there's any feedback or like input that you've got during the little bits that I talk about, feel free to just speak up and let us know, because I don't know everything. Let's get started. Android N, I'm sure you guys have all heard that the preview is out. Lots of really interesting things. In fact, this is you might not have heard about all the features because a lot of the features are actually under the hood. The user-facing features, the major ones, are well-known, but there's a lot of new settings, a lot of new toggles, and a lot of new developer options. We'll go through those. The Android N preview is available on a bunch of different Nexus devices. Interestingly enough, the Android One is still being supported. The updates are over the air, which is fantastic. So if you've got one of these devices, then you can just subscribe to or enroll to the preview program, you'll immediately get a notification and just download it like you would any other system update. And the same will be the case for the other preview releases. There are going to be 5 preview releases, approximately once a month. And the 4th preview release, we'll have a final API where you can actually publish apps to the Play Store. final release will have it will be around Q3. We'll see to that schedule. So the first major feature that people talk about is the multi-window support. There are three different types of multi-window support that are being introduced. I'm sure you've all heard of the split screen, which is basically two apps side by side. That's probably what will be used in most phones, and in fact is a feature that a lot of Samsung devices have had from development point and lifecycle methods. The major one that I'm aware of is both apps, when displayed, are not both in the foreground. One of them is in the foreground as a normal application, and the other one is in a paused state. So for developer, on pause gets called, and on stop does not. So you want to take that into account when bumping up your target API. The other mode, picture-in-picture, jump to the third one, is well known. It'll probably only be used for things like the Pixel player and maybe Chromecast. It's not that interesting. Freeform is the interesting one, where you'll have basically apps wherever you want them to be. This is going to be so yeah, like you've got the split screen mode. If you haven't already, we've got a Nexus 9 tablet flying around somewhere. We have a break later, feel free to play around with it. It's got the actual in preview on it. So if you want to take a look and play around, feel free. Split screen, I've talked about it. Still got some improvements to make. Windows mode. this is the really interesting one. This is the one. This is the one that Google have not, interestingly, talked about. So they've been very mute about it, but some.
Is it similar to the Sony, like Sony's little mods?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen them.
On the like tablet, the Z tablet and the Z1 and stuff, you could have like there'd be kind of widgets, but they were like little apps of their own, which were doing running on the screen, and maybe you could have them over the top of stuff and that.
Right.
Work so on other things as well.
Right. There's I know that Twitch has a feature where you can have like a window and window kind of feature, but that's more of an overlay on top of the screen. So that's different to any of the multi-window features that are being introduced now. But yeah, it is interesting. So the freeform, as it's been called, hasn't been talked about. I expect it'll be talked about thoroughly in IO, so something to look forward to. And I also expect that it'll be a big hint as to the future direction of Android, and in particular how Google is planning to get more involved in the desktop space. I have a little bit of a demo here for a video of this.
Okay.
Oh
yeah, like that.
I mean, it works pretty much as you guys would expect. This is how you get into multi-window. You touch the little square on the top right corner. You can resize windows. There's full mouse support. And there are a lot of background features that are enabling full keyboard support, like copy and paste. And as we'll talk about in a moment, there's also drag and drop support between activities that's being introduced. But you can see it's very much like what you'd expect from a modern operating system. It looks a little lacking, perhaps, but if you keep in mind that it's for a tablet, it starts to make a lot of sense.
I almost forget to learn a bit about responsive styling. Kind of
yeah. Ideas. Yeah. This is going to be very interesting to see how apps, especially apps that aren't targeting him, handle the different sizings. great. So in terms of development support for multi-window, it's really quite easy. So for per activity, you can state whether the activity is resizable in the manifest. Interestingly enough, it defaults to true. So any app out there currently that doesn't target in will be resizable by default, which is great. It means that the feature can be used straight away. You can specify things like minimum width and height and the gravity for defining how the app should interacts with other apps. So you'd say you've got an app in the foreground, and then your new so this app would come to the foreground. This is indicating that it should try to display itself on the top or at the end, which is the right side or left side, that type of lookup. Right, and just a note down the bottom saying that life cycle changes from one to multi-window is similar to switching from landscape to portrait, so just a standard configuration change. So in other words, everything should just work in theory. But again, we'll see how many apps end up supporting it. What I mentioned earlier, drag and drop support is not currently supported, but will be soon. As I mentioned by the fourth preview, this one, they're expecting to have all these features enabled working perfectly fine. But yeah, it's relatively straightforward, which is, again, it's great from a developer point of view, because these are great features which you hope every app has, so they're making them simple to implement, which is great. So that's multi-window. There's a whole bunch of changes to notifications as well. In fact, the whole styling of notifications and a lot of the quick settings UI has changed as well. But in particular, there's a new feature called Direct Reply, which, as you can see on the left, allows you to provide certain actions. And one of the action types allows the user to input some text. And for that text to be sent to your activity and then your application, and then your application can deal with it by like sending an SMS message or making a note or whatever is relevant to your application. So it's a great way to easily interact, to get the user to interact with your app without actually having to navigate to your app. There's also an ability to define history of messages in case your app is like a messaging app and you want the user to have context as to what the previous conversation was. So that's all great. Again, the implementation is really easy. You just create a new remote input object, give it some properties, then add it to your notification action, and then add your notification action to your notification, and display it. So again, very simple. Hopefully it'll get by lots of apps.
What will happen on with that?
That's interesting. Just the thought. Yeah. I guess on where it might come up as different cards, and then the card will be voice input.
Yeah, usually actions is you swipe to the swipe left and then you get a
maybe there'll be a button for it. It looks
like just of course like really simple text, not being really smart, so maybe voice.
Yeah, maybe just like a voice button. It's like, well, I'm expecting you to have some input, so can't get to do something. Bundled notifications. So by default, the notification drawer will bundle notifications together, so that instead of having a whole bunch, collapse into one, which is quite similar to what already happens on Android Wear. But now you'll also have the option to group them. So, perhaps, I don't know under what cases you might want to group them, but you can. and again, it's really simple, so that's great. Right, so as I mentioned earlier regarding notifications, the whole UI has been updated. And one the notification bit is suited to the branding of the app. Again, it looks quite simple, but then again, styling is never simple. So, yeah, this is the code side of it, and then on the back end, there'll be a whole bunch of styles which define exactly how the notification and its components look. Doze 2.0, this should be welcomed by everyone. Although it might be a little bit of a headache for some developers. So on the right hand side, on this side, that's Doze as the original Doze, where no wake locks are allowed, no network access is allowed, alarms, syncs, and jobs are deferred, and GPS and Wi-Fi scans are not allowed. This will occur if your device is stationary. However, Doze 2.0 is handling the case where the device isn't stationary, but the screen is off. So say you've got the device in your pocket, or you're just in your backpack or somewhere on you, which isn't necessarily on the desk or stationary. In that case, you'll see that you'll turn the screen off after a certain amount of time, which is undefined, a reasonable amount of time. Doze, like a less strict version of Doze, will come into effect, where network access will be limited, syncs and jobs will be deferred to those maintenance windows. So you can expect just day-to-day better battery life. You'll notice that some things like GPS, Wi-Fi scans, alarms, that kind of thing, and in particular wake locks, they're still allowed. So it'll improve the situation, but it's not like a solution to all our problems. Quick settings, going back to notifications. There's a new API for allowing apps to define their own quick settings, which is great. There's also been some changes, like you can see the quick settings on the left. When you drag down the notification pane, you'll have access to these quick notifications. If you drag it fully down, you'll have not only the standard quick notifications that we're known love, you'll also have pages of these quick notifications. You see the new page? So you can actually have multiple pages in case you want lots of different easy to toggle settings.
And you can have your apps setting button there, right?
Yeah. So you can now, well, you will be able to define your notification, and it'll just appear there if the user has added it to. So you can see on the right hand screen, you can, on the bottom, there are all the notifications available, which aren't currently visible to the user. And I believe you get to the right hand screen by pressing edit. You can drag up any quick settings that you want, and then they'll be available to the user. So it means that the user has a lot more control over their settings and the UI.
So they can also reorder them. So see the top at the top left, there are 5. So if you moved, say, flashlight to the very top left when you're editing, then the far left one will become the flashlight and the first screen. So you can decide what your top 5 are.
Oh.
Just found the flashlight.
Find the flashlight.
Yeah, so you can basically modify it. You can modify it as a user. I know it's not an adult, but I like the idea of that.
In terms of development, get a quick setting working, again, principle. There's a new tile service, which you get. You have to define the tile service. So in the manifest, just like you do in other service, you extend tile service, it'll have a whole bunch of different lifecycle callbacks. They're all fairly straightforward, quite simple. And in the service definition. I just want to point out the bottom two lines that are highlighted. So this guy and this guy, these two will always be the same for all settings. They are how the system recognizes that this service is for quick tile set. It's a quick tile set. So those two bottom ones need to be there, they'll always be there. The other three on top, customizable, the name will be the name of your custom top set. Yeah, so again, really, really simple features. Data saver. This is great for virtual countries or people that have limited data. It's quite similar to the existing cellular data and background data for app settings. The difference being that Data Saver is a system-wide background data restriction, which you can white label apps from. So basically, it applies to the whole system in the same way that cellular data does, but it only applies to apps in the background. And you can, as I said, you can white list apps. So certain apps that you want to constantly update, for example, Gmail. You know that it's not going to use a lot of data and you want it to always be up to date, so you can whitelist that and you always get background data. The other really important part of this API is that the app now knows when it's under data restrictions. So with the connectivity manager dot get restricted background status, you'll get one of these three flags, enable, whitelisted, or disabled. And that'll tell you, as a developer, how you should handle the data. So if you can, depending on the type of app, if the restricted background data is enabled, then you won't have access to data, and you can indicate to the user that this setting is enabled, or you can deal with it as need be. If you're whitelisted, then you know that the user wants to limit the amount of data that's being used, so as an app you can then make decisions as to trying to minimize the amount of data that you're using as an app. And if you're disabled, then you can just download all of those. Screen zoom. This is, I believe, a accessibility setting, but it could be quite useful to a lot of users. So much like the current text size resizing option. Unlike the current text sizing option, this will scale the entire device API. So internally, the device has a number which it uses to define what scale it draws the content at. And this is what is being modified here. So unlike the text scaling, everything increases in size. So you can see it's gone from 5 icons to 4 icons, everything is just blown up. Not just the text, but like all the icons, everything. Which is great for grammar. On the plus side, from a developer point of view, devices won't ever scale further than screen width. Screen width, 320 dp. So when you're developing an app, just make sure that your content works at that minimum size. And
I didn't get to the docs icon after what's below.
Yeah. Oh, that's
it looks like it's what you do for
screen. That's true. Where is the docs?
It's gone. It's been deleted.
That's deleted. Yeah, you expect those to be on the next line.
Yeah.
It's just because they couldn't fit. It's dark. I'm worried. Scoped directory access. Just like, this is Google's way of saying we don't really like new developers.
So true.
Just because, Google loves options, so it's providing us another option to manage our story. This is, I gotta say, I like the approach that they take. The way that this works is, instead of granting access to the entirety of the shared folder directory, which was the same directory that had the user's pictures, music, videos, files, download, all that kind of stuff. Instead of providing access to all of it, an app can now ask permission for a single folder inside one of those directories, and they can also choose which volume to request access to. So this is actually really important. So they're providing an API which allows, which directly supports SD cards. If an SD card is inserted into the device, it'll now be completely supported and allow the app to request storing data on it in a transparent manner. So something else to that. I just want to point out this isn't asking the user, or this doesn't give the app the ability to ask for any directory access. In particular, it doesn't ask, you can't ask for like system directory access, you can't ask for private app directory access. In fact, you can't even ask for the root SD card directory access. It's the Android shared directory that this is prompted to. So if you want the user to be able to select directory outside of that, you still have to use the standards in particular of the user path selection. Network security configuration changes. I'm not actually all that familiar with this stuff, but basically what it means is, as a developer, you no longer need to provide code level switches for things like trusting
sorry, you can skip this slide.
Self-scientific is when you're testing on your own server, is a test server, or you're trying to proxy through something like Charles, then previously you had to make your HTTP requester trust all certificates. Whereas now you can define in XML under different build configurations what exactly your HTTP request library should trust. And that's either through custom trust anchors or it's also an option to opt out of pre-test text traffic. So it basically it makes sure that your app isn't using HTTP or pre-text traffic in case you want to make sure that your user's data is always protected. So it's like a safety. Android for Work. If you're interested in Android for Work, you should definitely look at the changes. There are 22 different bullet points, which I wasn't going to talk about, and there's no way I'm going to list them all. But there's some really interesting sounding stuff there. So it definitely sounds like Android is, or Google is, putting a lot of effort into supporting the workplace. But in particular, I want to mention number 4. So it seems like they toggle word mode. It seems like the user will now be able to toggle all these different restrictions on and off so they can use the phone as they would normally at home. And when they enter work, they can toggle it back on and it'll add all those restrictions again. really use the device because it's so locked down. So you now be able to use it fully, which is just great. Java 8. Awesome. The Jet compiler is introducing language expressions, which is fantastic, especially because they're supported all the way back to three classes. So this means that we can now start making use of lambda expressions to minimize the amount of boilerplate code we've got. And just as a little example, I've got this button on the listener. So instead of defining the full, code, you just say V arrow and then the code that you need. So as you can see, it's a lot simpler, in particular for cases where you just need to call into something else or it's just simple code. It makes things it makes things a lot better in terms of reducing the amount of code and therefore making the code a lot easier to understand. The other Java 8 features we may as well just ignore because we're not going to be able to use them until your app has a minimum SDK support of 24, which is kind of sad, but anyway. The features are default interface methods, so this is really fantastic. You can now define default methods on interfaces, which means if there is a method which is shared among all your classes, you don't need to redefine it on every class or use a util or in some way find a way of reusing that method in all the different classes which implement the interface. You can now just define it in the interface and override it in whatever classes differ from the default implementation. Static interface methods can be useful in many different circumstances. Streams, again, they're I'm not that familiar with them, and neither am I with functional interfaces, but streams, from the little that I looked into them, and please correct me if I'm wrong, are a little bit like Rx Java. So that's really cool. They simplify things. They allow you to do some great sort of transformational programming. So that's something to look forward to in a few years' time.
So is this the actual switch to the OpenJDK then, or?
Yes, this is part of it. But mostly it comes from the Jack compiler.
Well, the API 24 plus stuff, that all sounds like OpenJDK.
Right.
I think the Lambda expressions is from the Jack compiler, sounds like.
Right, I'm not sure. I've got a little bit more to talk about. Oh, no, that's good. We'll get back to that in a moment. More stuff under the hood for developers. Deprecated broadcasts, the connectivity action, and the picture and video broadcasts are no longer being broadcast at all. They don't exist anymore. And that's because there were a lot of apps which were being triggered by these broadcasts. Which the result of the outcome was that a lot of apps were being woken up in the background and then shut back down because they weren't really interested in any of the apps. So the deprecation of these actions should be great in terms of battery life, but it also means that apps need to update how they expect this data to come in. In particular, the job scheduler should now be used. And the advantage of using the job scheduler is that you can specify a lot more finely what it is you're interested in, instead of just saying, oh, it's going to be changed. If you want to make sure that your app updates when connectivity changes to Wi-Fi, and there is internet, then you can specify that in the job scheduler, as opposed to just getting all connectivity changes broadcast. Using up the user's battery. There are also changes in resolving language resources. Oh, yeah, and multiple language support. Now, I know we're not the biggest multilingual country in the world, but it's actually a pretty good feature, supporting multiple languages. Roughly speaking, so that you guys can get an idea of how it works, is if a user defines two or more languages, say English and Chinese, then when the system resolves the strings, it'll try to first get English. It'll try to get first English, if that's the user's primary language. And if the string doesn't exist in English, then it'll go down to Chinese. And if the string doesn't exist in Chinese, then it'll default to whatever the default setting of the app is. So it basically gives the app a better chance to be able to communicate in the language that the user is familiar. So if you think about all these apps languages for us that are not in English, so say a user is familiar with Spanish and Portuguese, then it'll try to translate the entire app to Spanish. If some translations are available, it'll go to Portuguese. If not available in Portuguese, then it'll go to Spanish. So it introduces this whole other layer of resolving resources. What else? Get accounts permission is now being deprecated. I should probably have said how you're supposed to do that. Anyway, it's deprecated. There are other ways of getting the user's information, primarily through the contacts. What else? Private app directory. Right. Private app directory now has restricted access, which means that apps can no longer look into an app's private directory. They can't see any of its contents. So that has implications in terms of passing files around between different apps. If an app starts an intent to get a file from your application, you should not pass back a file to your URI. This is basically what it's getting at. Instead, you should make use of the file provider than the content instead. Otherwise, you can get into these tricky situations where the receiving app might not have permission to access the file, and that would be good for the user. So, make use of file providers and don't use file providers extending to your app. Direct boot. Yeah. Just direct boot. direct boot, I didn't look into it that much. It's basically, it allows your app to define a certain space which isn't encrypted. So, say for example, your phone overnight restarts. I don't know why it would have restarted, but say it does restart. Your alarm app can now define certain services or information to be available from the user's lock screen without the user unlocking the device, primarily to enable encryption of the device. So if the entire device is encrypted, then nothing can be started. But if your app defines some information in the in this unencrypted space, then it'll allow the app to start even though the device hasn't been unlocked and therefore it's still encrypted. So it's a great feature for enabling always encrypted devices. Some more stuff. I don't want to bore you guys too much. Vector drawable performance is apparently fantastic in Android N, so we should all start moving towards it. This is a small comment I mentioned. I'm sure you guys know when you install apps or when you get system updates, you have to wait ages for apps to optimize. That's basically Android compiling ahead of time all the apps, so it doesn't have to just be. The Android engineers, in all their wisdom, decided that actually, maybe we should go back to But it's got one slight change, and that they're basically, and don't ask me, they're caching the hot paths of applications, so that they're caching the JIT of these paths, with the idea being that they can reduce the startup time of applications, but get the added benefit of reduced memory usage for those applications. So all the other advantages, we don't have to wait forever during app installs and system updates. So that's something to look forward to. Audio latency reductions, using the low latency flags. It'll be nice to see if this works on handsets, but it's a step in the right direction. There's some render scripts improvements, there's OpenGL 3.2, plus Vulkan support coming soon, so hello VR. Improvements to ADB, EDK, IC, U4J, which is a translation library, sort of. There's a whole bunch of more dev options, there's system-wide night mode, and there's a whole bunch of more stuff. There's just so many improvements. It's pretty awesome. If you want to read more about these improvements, here's a bunch of information. In particular, I recommend the Droidcon keynote by Chet Romain. That's fantastic. It's about an hour long as well with it. And there's some other links in there which are very important. CommonSquare is also fantastic for in-depth analysis of some of the lesser known development. Features. So I wanted to get some input as to what you guys thought was going to be the next Android name. So I've just put some names in there. But can I ask you guys to put your hands up for like each of these? And then I'll just so Nutella?
That's trademark.
Three, four.
Nacho.
Nacho.
Okay. Nacho Libra.
Actually, Nacho is a good one.
How about cool. Natto? Stinky stuff.
Natto?
Yeah, fermented soybean. smells like weird. Smells like rotten meat. Tastes great.
That sounds great for a mascot.
Yeah. Well, NATO, yeah, that's even better.
Cool. Well, yeah, we'll see what else is announced at IO. If there's anything that you guys want more details on, then we can always do like a more extended discussion. Like, I'm sure we'll have more extended discussions about some of these features in the future. Awesome. Yeah, cheers. Thanks very much. Any questions?
You're resizing Windows, for example, the 3-4 more split screen mode. I'm interested in how the Google engineers handle that, like updating you as you're studying, because like, if there's a configuration change, does that mean it's going to try and do like 60 configuration changes?
Just
space.
But if you change his XML file because you've got a SW or whatever, W400, then it says, oh, hang on, we've just gone past that. I mean, I don't know.
Perhaps they just
good question.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's interesting.
It could be just looking at that system zooming stuff, and that's sort of being used for the redoing of the layouts on the fly. So the layout's not changing, but the actual, what it, when it pushes to the engine, that's chain it's doing it and just zooming it. So it kind of, because they've upgraded the vector drawer stuff as well, which kind of goes in some of that. Does that make sense? Like a,
I don't know.
Because I was looking at how that's, if that zoom cuts things off and stuff. It's something bigger, so it chips
right
over there, so they use some of that sort of stuff in it where it's triggering an engine level instead of the layouts having to change as such. It's recalculating those on the fly.
Yeah.
Rights to use it, that would be good. Yeah.
Second one, it's
predict much longer time for compilation for a building project. If it's you build small projects, it's not, you will not get any big problem, but for a huge project, in if it's only Android and Java, it took about just 20-30 seconds. But if you compile these Kotlin files, it took about 1.5-2 minutes. It's quite a long time for if you want to debug something. Yeah, but it's anyway, it's a very powerful tool, and I very recommend you to try to use. Matthew, here start a new project with only Kotlin just recently. And I think in future you will make a presentation. Can you?
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
I'm a fan already.
Yeah. And just my main thing is just put in its release and we can start to use it for better.
How far away do you think it is for people to be using it in production code? I mean, have people using it in production code?
It's because it's have a backability and that's everything work like expected, and you can use absolutely the same with Java and Kotlin files, and that's you can send the Java object to Kotlin and send Kotlin object to Java, and it's absolutely work together. Do you have any question? And now I want to talk about under the structure. About 1 year ago, we were starting our new project, and it must be a huge portal. We start to think about optimizing architecture, because if you see most of the tutorial, they all, every time, they make a lot of action in activity or fragments or something like that. And in this case, our UI become very, very smart. And we decided to split it something. We have a few features which we must think about. It's because project is huge, and we every time have something which we can reuse again. We want to separate UI and basic business logic for easy modification, easy change UI or backend, especially for example, if you decide to change API or decide to change database, it must be very easy to implement. And also, when you develop a complex project, on future time, it's become very difficult to maintenance. Because you have a lot of dependencies, and if you change something in one place, you must change it in another place. We also want to reduce this risk. And also testability, if you have huge classes, huge and very smart classes, it's very difficult to test. And we decide, we divide our project by models. At first time, we divide our project by path, but when we divide by path, it's become not very clear dependency. And now we use each feature. It's a special library project, and very clear you can see dependency, because you must show it in Gradle. And now you can see like patient model. It's know everything about node, task, and session, lab results. And you can use any classes or features from this model. But for example, already node model don't know anything about patient. And if you want to reuse this model, you we can very easy to implement it in new project. And it's allowed you to very clear, you can see which models dependent on each. And as well, we divide our project by layers. We have UI layer, business layer, and data layer. UI layer, it's working with Android API for UI. Business layer usually don't know anything about Android API. It's Java or Kotlin or something else. And data layer also work with data API from Android. In our project, we don't allow to have two-way interaction, and we don't want to make our classes very smart. And for example, UI layer know about loader, but loader already don't know about UI. Same loader know about manager, but manager don't know anything about loader. And if you're going from up to down, lowest level, don't know anything about highest level. If one model must communicate with another model, it's all communication is only from a manager. And the manager is like one single point for this model. And you can, if you want to communicate with this model, you all communication only from only this manager. Just now I will show how we implement this in Android. We have a standard loader in fragments, and which it's fragmented loader. It's loader which requests information from manager and return the DAW object, then we pass the DAW object to UI object and send the UI object to UI. Business layer, it's this manager. Manager have very simple method, it's public method, and just calling from controller. We can have multiple controller, for example, controller for network, or controller for camera controller, or reminder controller. And on the manager decide already which controller must be used. On this way, now controller working with agent. Agent, for example, the agent request from database from and some object. And if this object not exist, it's a request of this information from network. And agent is very simple. Just don't know anything from what's happening about. Just receive give me a question, going to the database, and return that object. Yeah, I when we divide this application for these features and layers, we very simplify each class. And very easy to debugging, and if you want to make some changes, you can very easy to find some way, and easy to move some models to another project, and easy to test. Okay. You have any question? Actually, it's not still just in fix, because we every time add some features and remove some features. because, for example, recently we in Manager, we've managed not only the not like entry point in the model, it's also the used for manage threads. But now we decide to move everything to loader, and now only loader manage threads. And every time we update some information, some and now we start to use Kotlin, and we want to get some features which are allowed to do.
Sure. So the edge was so visible, you know?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Suite of services using the sort of microservices approach, and I'm wondering if you have a variety of things you want to do at different levels, if this architecture would give you that flexibility.
What do you mean by a variety of things?
Okay, well, some of the microservices architecture is, you know, there'll be a whole service related to auth. And then another one that's, you know, doing something and serving up all of your images. And another one. So if you're taking this approach, if you have a whole layer of sort of, they're all at the same kind of functional strata,
mm-hmm.
but they're doing different things, can you have your branches spreading out as well as addressing the differences between the UI and the data strata? Do you understand my question? No. Okay.
Yeah. Do you know, it's different feature modules making use of other feature modules?
Yeah.
Oh, on the same.
The same level.
On the same horizontal level. Yeah.
No, we're not allowed to do that. We prefer to have only one point for because it's more easy to maintain. Because, for example, if you have one module. Other module, and they will cross-communicate in each level.
Mm.
If you decide to move to another project, it becomes very complex to do that. Because you already have a lot of dependencies. But if you have only one point, you just must rewrite only one interface.
Yeah, I think with the microservices, you'd be more like decoupling the UI from the service layer,
mm-hmm.
and then the service layer could be used by an EUI component. So you'd have, you know, and UI components and a bunch of services underneath, and then they would each call whatever they needed to use.
Mm-hmm.
So similar layering, but just with a different idea in mind or a different concept behind it.
And the objects that you're passing along are standardized for the interfaces?
We just use a different object for each level, but it can be any object. You request required for that object, so with the data information and the UI object, have a UI render UI object. For example, in a business object, this can be just some model, or and in a UI object, that's already can be cursor for easy work with a cycle.
Hmm. And does the layer receiving that object validated every time it gets it, or send it to local. It's on this case, it's
approach the same question. Does this structure have a way that you should call into other apps that follow the same structure? Like, should you go straight into the manager level of a conceptually separate app, or should you communicate purely through the backend or purely through the UI, or each thing at its own level? Well, no, not for Android apps, but if you were writing apps in that style, or even Android apps that were operating on the same device.
They're doing a management thing, then they're talking with each other's management level.
Yeah. Sort of thing. Oh, but if you had a notionally separate app that you could call into its management level, would you? Go through a shared backend service, or would you handle it in your own layer or what? Because that's more conceptually similar to microservices than like lots of apps.
You want to be control on all these requests. You can create some kind of future module, and for example, all receivers and other stuff could be there, and this module will decide where to go, might be future by credentials. Another has rights to call this one and refuse or accept this call. In this kind of situation, it makes sense to create this model. But if it's something simpler and you don't need to these kind of restrictions, maybe it makes sense for different models has their own features just receive it straight away. Knows module receives something. This manager can decide what to do, or another user can decide what to do. Go to the manager or send response.
You're asking what?
Yeah, but at what point should this like, should it be segregated to the manager level, or should it?
I think it should be because managers are like, if I'm sure that they want something inside this module, for example, I want to get some information about some manipulation, then I go to manager. And then this which will receive your request will be more about future requests. Yeah, I think it should be different. Because it's not about this is what this module, it's more about interacting with also.
Regarding the Android UI, I noticed that like the UI aspect of the communication flow is the very top, but even within that UI layer, you've got different, considered different layers, like the activity at the bottom, the fragment is a little above the activity, right? Do you guys have like a particular design for that in addition to broader, like do you use fragments?
Yeah, the for one feature almost we have one activity, and this activity we have some fragments, and but like a decision to move to another activity, and it's a from activity, and then we have just a listener in fragments. Yeah, and the fragments are loaders and adapters.
Is there a reason why you might not do that?
Yeah, we're not using it, just make you start to use a new project, and we'll use this in the future, but we didn't use it.
No, we were using, but I totally understand, using asynchronous. You know, but it's a progression, I was just curious.
For example, Kotlin, they have very good features about what Dennis was saying.
The thing about loaders is loaders really good type activity lifecycle.
Yeah, yeah.
Loader manager, fragment manager.
Yeah,
that's why we're trying to use loaders on UI level. yeah, with something in the background. Because yeah, you can run your thread and then try to understand what state you have to do all this stuff.
Yeah, it's not always the case that it works well, but yeah,
I don't get, I felt the same way, but we kind of just moved away from that to using observables and ones that hang around for a little bit. We've kind of got ones that hang around, you can sort of set a bit of time to say, well, if there's nobody subscribed, or if you've got a result, cache for a bit, so that when you rotate or something like that, it can go and get the result of previous requests quite quickly, things like that. But I know what you mean. There's quite a lot to load, but there's a lot of stuff to build. It's interesting. It's really interesting to see why people do things.
See in the marketplace yet that incorporates some of this stuff? We appreciate how well you use it.
I'm not sure about the marketplace because Orion is more about B2B.
Yeah.
But yeah, maybe there will be some consumer apps in the future.
Cool.
Yeah, I'm sure that most of them will be similar.
So you built basically a building out a library, right?
Yes.
What sort of apps do you use in the B2B market, if you can tell us anything about that? I mean, most of the stuff that you see with apps is consumer-oriented, so I'm just kind of curious.
Just any software.
Can you give an example of something, or?
You don't have to. I mean,
I'm just trying to figure out what's meant by B2B app. So you're saying like in hospitals and managing patient information, that sort of thing?
For example, like a main current product that is for collect data from different services for one place from different protocols,
uh-huh.
And the presence is doctors.
No. And look back to your slide number 11, and it reveals the secrets.
Ah, yeah.
All the modules.
Yeah, yeah.
No, seriously, go back to slide 11, and you'll see that the DT object or get patient turns into a get patent. So it's actually everything becoming a intellectual property as test.
Ah, okay. I think it's really exciting that a few years ago we were tinkering around with async tasks and sorts of little bits and pieces, and now we're getting to a stage where we're running libraries. We're apparently working on a library for something which and that's kind of it's kind of exciting, right? Like we're now building tools to help build things better, right? And I mean it's difficult because it's, I don't know if you guys find it rapid, but I find it extremely rapid the change. But yeah, if you guys I really appreciate
it's really hard to sort of show you stuff. No one really knows. Like in 6 months time, you've probably done that better. You know, hopefully that's generally how it feels every time and stuff. So yeah, really appreciate you talking about it. It's a really good idea. If you want to talk about some, you know, we could revisit this subject if someone else has got a different approach, or, you know, because they wanted to do something differently, or they see the use of it being used differently. So, don't be shy to put your hand up and do a talk on it. That'd be cool. Of course, we've got a talk coming up, but other than that.
Yeah, so
announcements. Does anyone have anything they want to announce, talk about, discuss, or move on?
Yeah, anyone want to say they've got betas they want people to try out? Maybe not possible ones, but
any personal project that might be working on that you might want to talk about? Okay, yeah, can help on.
Let us know if there's anything that's going on there. So, you're always looking for people to talk about that.
Are you saying a word about IR Extended?
Oh, yeah. So, so IR Extended is coming up.
Yeah, so we're hosting a Google I/O Extended event, which basically means that if you're crazy enough to wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning, we're going to be here. So,
fourth floor.
We're moving in like 3-4 weeks. So, I/O is going to be upstairs. The next GDG is going to be upstairs. There won't be a next GDG, so the next GDG will be in
June. I think we'll do something in mid June. Or like the second week of June, that's what I'm thinking.
Not casting.
So it'll give us a few weeks to kind of digest what comes out of IO, yeah.
Not casting it 3D and then say, can you use Google Cardboard? Or looking at it like that?
Actually, I'd be really interested. Not entirely surprised if they did stream it in 3D.
Google casting.
Yeah, I saw that. What's more real?
Obviously, we're on the stream.
You see that?
So Google I/O, if you want to show up at ridiculous clock, then feel free to sign up to GDG. We do have limited spots.
And if you don't get a spot, you can watch the stream of us watching.
But do sign up so that we know numbers, because there will be some food. And there will be some
cronuts.
You can wear some bits and pieces anyway. It'd be fun. So, it's a limited space. So do sign up. Don't sign up if you're not going to come. Like, we want people who are committed. Right. To be crazy.
It's
going to
be crazy. It's going to be crazy. On the announcements topic, one other thing that is coming up next week is the Auckland JVM group, as you mentioned, is having a meeting on microservices. So that's Wednesday. Up next week, you might be interested.
Tuesday.
Oh, Thursday, yeah, that's right. This is Wednesday. Yeah,
sorry, I changed the sentence. It's a confusing word. But seems to be working out right.
And it's a spot.
So, is that, if you're looking for a job, if you know anyone that's looking for an Android developer job, we're always interested in that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's news.
If you're in Southern Hemisphere, of course. It said though, also Game of Thrones is coming, so.
Right.
So, in a way, really, which one is
going?
Game of Thrones follows in Southern Hemisphere.
Now, if you want to have a meeting to live stream Game of Thrones,
we might have a few problems.
At least any of
Netflix, you know. Oh,
Yeah, this is going to be a best risk prize. I always get.
Oh, yeah. Come best as an Android. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, well,
as an Android.
But April 1st, who had a good April Fool's gag? Pulled or.
Like I said, Google did two of the best ones, that Google Plastic and the style recognizer on the auto picture categorizing.
I'll probably play the Google
That's funny.
Plastic one at the end.
Okay, yeah.
Good. This should be.
Oh, they
said this should be March.
Style
finishes.
Finishes.
It's like we have photos. I'll keep the lights on so that we can sort of
keep this
For those of you that weren't here last month, this is basically just a casual news section. It's just so that we all know what's been going on in Google Land, and it's open for discussion. So if there's something that you find interesting, feel free to speak up, especially if you know something about it. Anyway, as you all know, this happened. We've talked about it. We can move on. Pixel Seat. Right, so this is discounted, in particular the EMU, which, spoiler alert, I suspect has a lot to do with the EMU, and we'll find out more about it. We'll see. It's a great device. Some of you might have seen it. It's fantastic tablet, as far as I can tell. And it seems like it's going to be very promising, and it's going to be potentially a big part of Android and Android as a desktop platform.
Who's like Google's done it themselves, or is someone manufactured it?
I don't know if we know officially who's manufactured it, but it's not branded.
Hmm.
It's a Google product, much like Nexus.
Not the Nexus.
That's an LG, right?
Yeah. So I yeah, it's for the brand.
Yeah. But there are some that are.
Could
have been what the startup called
you independent. So, could have been what the startup
called
you independent.
Oh, really?
Okay.
Well, there you go. Yeah, it's supposed to say this. So, yeah, you can expect Google quality.
And you can get them here, like obviously you're that one.
Yeah, $600 on sale to you. So, they're usually at
from
800 to 600.
Through there, though.
Right, the other big news is there was in March there was some Google Cloud Platform Next, which was the big GCP meetup. And there were a few announcements in that, mostly around some new APIs, and those APIs mainly involved around cloud machine learning. So a lot of stuff that powers things like now and Google Photos is now being open to the public. For example, I believe it was already available, the Translate API and Cloud Speech API, but it's now being joined by the Cloud Vision API. I've got a neat little video here that we'll play in a moment. All of this stuff, including TensorFlow, is now being open sourced. All this machine learning stuff is available through the cloud platform. And it's really interesting stuff.
They just started to saw the copy of the Google recently. But basically, they're making videos for it. So yeah, just want to. I'm personally going to be looking at this. It's something I want to know about, but I don't know quite enough about. So they're going to take you through step by step how to understand what you're doing. And they're using a lot of open source libraries to do it. I specifically mentioned some New Zealand open source library that he typically liked, that he was going to develop here, I mean. So, yeah, that's just something I'm personally liking.
And on the topic of videos, I've got to say, Google has made recently a lot of effort to provide very informative and useful short YouTube videos teach developers how to use stuff, how to optimize stuff, tips, suggestions,
just a little perspective on this. Google is the number three cloud service provider. So Amazon is way out in front. Microsoft is number two. And so part of the reason they're doing this is just trying to get some more developer attention and love to try and catch up. I interacted with the Amazon Web Services. What they think is going to be Amazon's next billion-dollar product is this thing called Alexa. Have you heard of it? So it's taking all of this sort of speech API stuff to your home. And they actually have the consumer product already that people in the States are buying it. They're talking to it. They're asking what's the weather, play my music, get my Uber, order my pizza, look up something on Wikipedia, all by voice. And so just in the last week, you know, I had never heard of this thing, and it turns out they've got a whole speech developer kit, a Udemy course that explains it with a bunch of videos, how you get the skill developer kit and design your own voice interaction skill that you could then add to the library of functionality that this device has, including ways that you could then monetize that. So it's like a whole new app store for apps that aren't anything that you phone at all. It's like you're talking to it and it's talking back. So Google wants to get in on this, obviously, and this is the way they think they're gonna get people to pay attention. But it's a struggle because Amazon's already got the product out there.
Well, certainly Google's got a potential, you know, a large market.
Yes.
Either in your pocket or your wrist,
yep.
In front of you. But yeah, it's going to be very interesting. And competition is always good. So
yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so there's a whole bunch of different APIs that are available. It's just a for you. It's about the vision and speech APIs.
From your application. And the API will respond with a text transcription of your Cloud Speech API allows application developers to use Google's best-in-class speech recognition technology through a simple API. You can send audio data directly to the cloud from your application, and the API will respond with a text transcription of your audio. Cloud Speech API uses the same machine learning technology we use for the advanced voice recognition features on Android devices, such as voice search in the Google app and voice typing in Google Keyboard. What's the weather in Tokyo? The API supports over 80 languages and provides high recognition accuracy even in noisy environments. We encapsulate sophisticated speech recognition models built on years of Google research with an easy-to-use API for any app developer. So any application can now listen and implement voice interactions with your users using the power of cloud computing. Let's see the speech API in action by calling it directly from a Raspberry Pi Copilot Go robot. The bot can capture audio through its microphone, send it to the cloud, and receive the recognized text in response in real time with partial results returned while the user is speaking. Now, let's see how it works. Can you dance? You can also specify the API what language you'd like to recognize. Mare, Migi. Vire, Esquerda. You can combine speech API with the other Google Cloud APIs. In our bot, we have combined it with Vision API to run OCR on an image of text. Can you read this? Speech API supports both streaming recognition and non-streaming recognition. That means means the API is best suited not only for real-time recognition, like I demonstrated, but also for batch recognition use cases, such as transcribing voicemails, podcasts, call center calls, or processing any stored voice data. As well, the speech API lets you add an interactive and voice-activated interface to your application with the power of Google Cloud Platform. Please go to cloud.google.com/speech for
cute, but I tell you, it is lame compared to if you Google Echo Dot and watch the video for the Amazon product.
Yeah,
this is a minute long, and this girl wakes up and goes through this whole routine of interacting.
Okay, no, we'll play that stuff.
I know, it sounded like it was a synthesized voice.
Yeah.
A lot of it did. Occasionally she had some intonation in there, but otherwise it sounded computer. Yeah, when it was reading, when it was giving the computer-generated voice response, it sounded a lot like her.
Another library that Google has provided this month is VRView. It's just an easy way of integrating spherical photos or videos or full VR canvas into your Android, iOS, or web platform. So take a look if you're interested in your users to interact in that way. Microsoft Build Conference was also this month. And the big news there is that Xamarin will be free to use. Xamarin is a targeting platform development. And you can basically develop Android and iOS apps using C Sharp with a shared purpose with native findings. So you effectively get similar to native performance while only supposed to be coding ones. So that's going to be interesting to look at. Also, Windows 10, the next version of Windows 10 update, will apparently mirror it, or have the option to mirror it. So it's interesting the direction that Microsoft is taking to support in some degree. Oracle is seeking $9.3 billion from Google for Java API usage. We'll see what happens.
Haven't settled it yet.
It keeps going around.
Yeah. And the numbers just keep getting bigger.
Yeah, it's insane. Material design. There's a new spec added to the script design, which is quite a navigation. You may see it in apps here again, and if you need it, it's now specified in the guidelines. Google Voice Hacking. So on Reddit, there are a whole bunch of posts this month about what you can do with OK Google commands. There's a whole bunch of them, and I'm actually thinking of doing a talk at some stage in the future about different voice APIs, voice interaction methods that are available, as well as some more details on Google Voice Hacking. You guys are interested in that? No?
It's such a hidden interface for a device.
Yeah.
And it's had to remove it. So it's something I've found with the Android Auto, if you said, say that play music on something, then I don't know how people learn that. People don't either take the time. Or
how are you supposed to know?
It's just saying, that you can choose which application by using the word on.
Yeah.
I found so far that it works really well if you just say kind of what you're after. Like,
yeah,
this is true.
Send a text message to Justin saying blah blah blah.
Yeah.
Say that all in one sentence and it gets off.
It's the same with remind me to do something. You know, it's pretty. I use it's pretty much the not the only one. It's the core use of voice interaction is reminders. Because I'm in a hurry, and I can't be bothered writing down. It says you can just type it into the browser at the top, remind me to do something, it will say you as well. So I did it as well. Because it just basically makes a search query to Google, and Google says, oh, wait a minute. So this is trying to communicate with me, I better do something about it. So
here's a small list, well, relatively comprehensive, if you ask me, of different things that you can do. So as I said, like look through it, because it can be useful, especially if you use it on occasion. Because there can be some good things for it. Do a barrel versus. In particular, just some that I want to know, like add X to my shopping list, or add the following items to my to-do list, or add items to Google Keep. Start a timer is something that I use a lot for cooking. Set a timer for 5 minutes, and then after 5 minutes, I get a reminder that my cooking is burnt. remind me, as Julius was saying, remind me when I get to work, or remind me, you know, when I get home to do something. This is fantastic because, you know, you're on the go, you can't always remember everything. So it's written down and it'll bug you all too often.
I use it with cables. Like, you know, you need a cable at work. I haven't got one. I know I've got one at home. Remind me to pick up that cable. Or when I get to work the other way around, remember to bring back that cable.
Yeah. And you can actually train your phone to identify your voice at Google, and you can get it to enable Google commands even when your screen is off or locked. You can go into the Google Now settings. You can do that. Navigate home and open it. Or call and text. Actually, texting can be working quite well.
I've hooked some of this, started hooking some of this into a thing called Alert Voice, which you take that, parameterize the Google Now stuff so they recognize parts of it to be variables that you can use in Pasta or other automation apps.
Yeah.
Just start playing with it.
That's really cool. It's like, Tasker is a great use of those features, but also, like, developers. Into OK Google process and provide users with a lot more customization as to what the voice commands achieve. Like you can say if you had a music app, you can say OK Google play.
It does that in the whole room. It really does.
Yeah, play. I was wondering when that was going to happen.
Yeah.
Play a rock album, and then you can get the app to open, and then the app can start to interact with the user by saying, you know, you've got these app albums, would you like to play a recent app album? Yes.
You've got to play this app because it's got the whole thing.
Okay, I'll do that in a moment.
Yeah.
Just finish here. Google Voice improvements. So I'll put these slides up if you guys want to take a look. This is quite neat, and it goes back to what we're talking about here. They're improvements of how the Google Voice is sounding so natural. That's entertaining and informative. There's also destinations on Google. Look at it.
Got some downtime waiting in line for your morning coffee? Why not plan and book your next big trip with destinations on Google? Just tell Google Search where you're thinking of heading, add destination or vacation, and you're off. Check out the top spots right from your search results. You can compare prices at a glance and see the next dates when fares and rates are low. To personalize your results, just select your dates, who's flying with you, and how much you want to spend, or not spend. Your results are automatically updated. Think you found the place? Now, you can search and check out popular itineraries from people who have been there, done that. Voila, you're ready to book your dream trip. Right from Google. Just slide left or right to see estimated trip prices for the next 6 months as Google compares millions of flights and hotels together in real. That's it. Planning and booking your vacation is easy. Now, all you have to do is...
So this was that destination?
Yeah.
So just to give you an idea of one of those features that you probably would never know until you accidentally made a search query and wow, you get all this amazing information. So if you are planning a trip, just try to search this. There's that DroidCon videos. Oh, if you're a developer, there's some great content. There's some great content. In addition to all the other things I've mentioned in that talk. And that's it. So if you guys want to hang out a bit, let's go to
Google Echo Dot. I'm not sure it's a YouTube video.
Alexa, alarm off. Alexa, what's on the calendar today? You have 12 minutes. Alexa, call me Uber. Your Uber will arrive in 2 minutes. Alexa, what's the weather like today? There's a 100% chance of showers. Alexa, pair my Bluetooth speaker. Okay, paired. Alexa, it's time to reorder some paper towels. Okay, order placed. Alexa, play my garage music.
We're playing your garage playlist from Crown Music.
Alexa,
play some jazz. Playing some jazz from Prime Music.
Alexa, who's this?
This is Picnic Basket by Long Tone.
Alexa, turn that up.
Alexa, ask Domino's to send me my last order.
Okay, order placed.
Hey, isn't that Jason Schwartzman?
No, that's not him. I would know if that was him.
I'm pretty sure it's him.
Okay, Alexa, who stars in Mozart in the Jungle? Stars include Malcolm McDowell, Jason Schwartzman.
Ah! See?
Okay. Alexa, change the bedroom temperature to 65 degrees. Okay. Alexa? Okay. Alexa? Good night. Good night. Sleep tight.
$89 US.
Oh. Is there a monthly fee or anything like that?
I'm aware of it. You want to sign up for Prime, obviously, so you could get everything else. But,
right.
Yeah.
But she looks quite lean, though.
Just saying. Like, I don't want to. You know, nothing wrong with that.
She might get some dual personalities, like not Alexa, but something else. You know?
So this is something Google is doing.
How am I looking?
You could talk to the browser now.
Oh, yeah. It talks to the browser.
Check this out.
So, web speech API demonstration for those that do web technologies. Hello, Google. What is it that I'm saying? Is this going to be one of those ridiculously embarrassing demonstrations? What is the bit I'm saying is going to be one of those ridiculously embarrassing instructions?
It's pretty close.
That's doing better with the client.
One of those instructions. So yeah, it's you know, it's pretty good. Actually, I've got a partner whose English is not the first language, and she's been using this, well, not this exactly, but she's been using Google to transcribe her voice, because she does a lot of writing, like essays and reports, and she's been finding it fantastic for her RSI. So it's not perfect, but it does a really good job.
I'm surprised they haven't put out a little Windows app for it to replace Dragon and Dictate or something.
Yeah.
Maybe you can just write one quickly in DB or something.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's everything. Thank you all for coming.
You can use your Android device as a digital keyboard, eh?
My biggest fear is someone's going to get bored and hack into it. Your whole
house because of chaos and stuff like that.
But you can get to like the BMC control or Windows device.
Or
even
Tom.
So you can have that.
There's
and then you use your Android device as a secondary keyboard.
Right.
Instead of having the own app.
So where were you studying?
At Open University.
No.
Corn Institute. Yeah, I because I want to study to just look at something from Russia. I'm trying to find something not so expensive.
Oh, yes.
And I'm trying to go to and create science website, and I was looking at all institutes that was introduced software development courses at the foundation. It's not so much free of fire, and the institutes. Currently, just 1 year. I was in Russia, but it was not something like that. Business management software. This is a Russian platform and Russian language, everything in Russian.
The Java language?
No, sorry, I mean the programming language. Yeah, programming language.
Russian programming
language.
It
was a really interesting situation. Some company, they got the, maybe somebody from the campaign to government, and government support this company, and everybody. All companies, all firms in Russia has to have accounting information on this software.
Well,
yeah.
Okay. So everyone has to know about it.
Well, yeah, right. Russia is a really big country. And in Russia, we came here, and we understand that it's really clean. We don't have dust.
Industry. Oh, actually, because it rains a lot.
No. You've got a different type of soil.
Yeah.
In Russia, you've got clay everywhere, and it was really surprising. You know, we understand that everybody has to get the shit from of the dogs.
Yeah, you pick it up.
Yeah. But in Russia, no. And every time we're in springtime, when the snow melts everywhere, bottles, the packets, everything. Do you know about World War II? And the German quote says the Russian. That was really popular in our movies. Because I understand that Russian people is really dirty. I don't know why.
No, I think it depends. It's a big place.
I'm sure every time you can see somebody who throws away the rubbish on the street.
Right. It's a shame.
Yeah, it's a shame. I understand, but not everybody.
Yeah.
But here I understand that some regions are not so clean, but some regions are really amazing.
Yeah, we try. People try. You can't get everybody thinking the same.
Yeah,
especially when we have lots of different cultures as well.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
From all different parts of the world.
So.
Okay, well, look, let me give you a card.
We're going to see what we're doing. Yeah,
just
six
months.